God wants us to appeal to our higher nature, to have control of our lives.
Sean, let's suppose that we're not on It Is Written television.
Okay.
And I come to you for counsel, and I say to you, Sean, give me a few quick principles to help me over a gambling addiction. You're my pastor. And
all
I confess to you, and I say I'm involved in gambling. What are you going to say to me?
Well, first of all, you know, the first positive step you've already taken, but that someone else that's listening today might want to take, is first of all to admit there's a problem. Mm-hmm. Right? 1 John 1 verse 9 says that if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That term confess indicates that we agree with God that there's a problem. We come to Him and say, listen, I can't control this anymore. I need to come back to You and have You control my life. That is the first step. The first step is simply to admit there's a problem, to come to God and say, I need Your help. I'm out of mm-hmm. control. That's the first step. Now, if you've come to my office, you've already taken that step. Here are some things I think I could show you quickly from Scripture that might help you in beating that addiction. Let's take a look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 57. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 57, right near the end of that book. Here's what Paul writes. But thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, notice what God says. I'm going to give you victory over this. He's not saying if you struggle hard enough, you can beat gambling. He says, I'll give it to you. Now, if I were to write you a check, Mark, today, and I'm not going to, but if I were to write you a check for $1,000, how hard would that be to take from me?
It'd be pretty easy.
It'd be very easy, right?
I mean, I could take it pretty quick.
You could take it quick. I know you could. Now, it's not going to happen. I want you to know that. But if you were to get a gift, most people take it. Children understand this. Children don't take a gift at their birthday and shake it and say, well, I don't really believe this is for me, Mom and Dad. Take it back. They just accept that gift. God says, I can make you a non-gambler today. Just take what I'm handing you. So in faith, we call ourselves a non-gambler. We're not a gambler in recovery the rest of our lives. We claim it as victory from God. But there's more to it. We say, okay, God, in faith, I accept Your promise. I no longer have a problem with gambling because You promise I can have victory. You're giving that to me. Next thing we need to do, Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. It says in Romans chapter 6 and verse 11, listen to this principle from the Bible. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Here's God's principle for victory. First, claim the victory. Now, as you're driving down the streets of Las Vegas and you see those bright lights and you remember how much fun you were having at the table and the old nature comes back and you say, I want to go to the table and gamble. You say, no, I have victory from God and I am dead mm-hmm. to that sin. Right? If we had a cadaver or a corpse, Mark, and we brought him to the roulette table, how much could he win?
Be very difficult.
Right. He couldn't put his chips on the table, right? You claim the promise, you tell yourself, I am free because God says so. I am dead to gambling. One other quick principle is found just a few chapters over in Romans chapter 13. This is an important one. This is an important one. It says in Romans 13, 14, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lusts thereof. Mm-hmm. If God has given you victory over gambling, Mark, do you need a deck of cards in your house?
Not at all.
Not at all, right? Do you need dice?
Not at all.
You don't need those things because we have victory and we're dead to it. So an important stage is, now let's go through that house. Let's pick up everything that reminds us of gambling or might tempt us to it. Let's clean house. Let's put it in a bag and burn it. Let's get rid of it. We don't need those things anymore. And then, like faith, by faith, like Peter walking across the water, we keep our eyes on Jesus. We look at His example and we pray for that victory every day. Another thing that might help, of course, is accountability. Right? Proverbs is at 27 and verse 17 says, as iron sharpens iron, so does a friend sharpen your countenance. I know I'm paraphrasing a little, but that text indicates that if we can hold hands with somebody and have somebody to pray with, perhaps a pastor, a trusted Christian friend, they can help us as we claim that victory from God.
Sean, that counsel is so practical, and I know it'll help our viewers today. Gambling can easily become an addiction that clashes with our Christian values. The Christian ethic is fundamentally opposed to gambling. The two are mutually exclusive. The Bible teaches it is God that gives us the power to get wealth. Deuteronomy 8, verse 18, as we read earlier. Wealth is a tool in the hands of a Christian to meet their family's needs, bless others, and advance the gospel. Gambling places the focus on getting rich quick. It focuses on defying the odds. It risks money that God has placed in our hands as a sacred trust. It appeals to the earthly focus that sees money as an end in itself, the solution to all my problems. In Eden, before sin, God placed Adam in the garden to tend and keep it. Useful, productive work was ordained by God to give all humanity a sense of dignity, self-respect, and purpose. Get-rich-quick gambling schemes rob us of the joy of God-ordained useful work. Gambling plays into the human heart's lust for more. It really feeds on greed. The wise man's words speak to this generation in Proverbs 13, verse 7. There is one who makes himself rich, yet has nothing. Tens of thousands of people have won and lost hundreds of millions of dollars gambling. In the end, they're defeated, discouraged, and depressed. The Lord has a better plan, he says in Matthew 6, verse 33. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. When we place his kingdom first in our lives, he promises to meet our needs. When a relationship with him is the passion of our lives, he commits himself to provide all necessities. The God who created us loves us with a never-ending love. Whatever troubles us, troubles him. Whatever concerns us, concerns him. He is the pot of gold at the end of our rainbow. He is the pearl of great price waiting to be discovered. He is the treasure hidden in the field. In him are all the riches of eternity. Slot machines will only take our money in the end. The lotto will only leave us with less in the end. Addiction to gambling will only leave us empty pockets and empty wallets in the end. But Jesus will leave us full. He will leave us satisfied. He will leave us content and happy and overflowing with joy. Would you like to say, Jesus, I want you to come in and control my life now and forever, as Sean prays.
Let's pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, today we are delighted to see that you have a plan to provide for all of our needs. Somebody watching the telecast today, Lord, is struggling. They're struggling with an addiction to the gambling tables, to the slot machines, to that deck of cards. Lord, they know in their hearts they'd like to be free of that. Today they'd like to claim victory because you offer it as a gift in Jesus Christ. Today they'd like to break free and walk holding your hand, knowing that life has a plan and a purpose and that you are in control. Lord, grant us the ability to be good stewards, to represent Jesus Christ to this world, and to walk hand in hand with him. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.